It probably comes as no surprise that as consumers, we want to have a positive impact with our money and our purchases. But how does this translate to behaviour, especially when it comes to fashion? And how ethical are certain fashion brands? In today's episode, we are going to unravel the complex relationship that Australians have with ethical fashion, as highlighted in the latest Baptist World Aid Ethical Fashion Guide, which our team have had the incredible opportunity to be a part of. So joining me today to discuss this is our research strategist, Jason Authers. Jace, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. It's great to be here and super excited to be talking about this as fascinating set of research.
It's really, I think, a bit of a landmark piece that I remember learning about and hearing about when I first started at McCrindle, maybe even before then. And then to know that we had been involved in the past and that we have been involved in this latest iteration of it is a bit of a proud, I feel, a moment for on behalf of, you know, someone who works at McCrindle. So I know that you've been quite involved in it, which is why we've got you on the podcast today to discuss just some of the insights, because it is a huge report. It's also a really beautiful, visually stunning report. I know, remember when we showed it in one of our team meetings, it was really, really cool to have a look at. So of course, people on the podcast can't see it, but they should definitely go and check that out. But as a key project lead on this research, Jace, could you explain a bit of the background to this research and this this great piece of research that's mainly, of course, initiated by Baptist World Aid?
Yeah, brilliant. The project fits into a broader research and advocacy strategy within Baptist World Aid, and they're obviously a great organization that exists to help, you know, aligned alongside our values, empower human flourishing, which we're excited to partner with so many clients and organizations that exist with those same values and purpose. And they release in 1 year an ethical fashion guide, which speaks to the brands that we know and love as Australian consumers. And it provides a score for those brands as to the how ethical or how sustainable their products are in the supply chain. This specific set of research looks at and considers the consumers and how Australian consumers are engaging with fashion generally, but also how they factor in ethical considerations and sustainability, etc. And so we conducted this research with them, as you mentioned, in the past in 2021. And as we now conduct it again in 2023, we wanted to look at how things have changed and how Australians are continuing along this trend of engaging with fashion as it becomes more and more global, how they're thinking about fashion, how they're purchasing and making their product decisions and their behaviors around what they choose to buy. And so this year specifically, Be Savory Free is another organization that engaged with us on this project as a co-funding partner. And so just wanted to mention that there as well.
Yeah, thanks, Jace. It's a really interesting report. It's visually quite stunning. And when I was looking at it in preparation for this episode, it was just a really fascinating one, I guess, because like you mentioned, there are a lot of brands that are mentioned in that report where they get kind of scored on a whole range of different measures, some which you touched on there, which is really interesting. And I think, you know, personally, I was looking at the brands that I often buy from or the brands that I have a more awareness of, and just interesting to see how they get evaluated. So, I mean, we're not here to talk about specific brands in this podcast today, although people can go and access that research that's in the report. But the aspect that you mentioned there around the Australian consumer kind of psyche and their intention when it comes to engaging with brands and fashion and their purchasing decisions is a really interesting one. It does link to our virtuous consumerism kind of trend that we have been watching and observing and commenting on, I think, over the last couple of years, whereby consumers are holding the brands that they engage with to a high standard. And we did actually look at that in the Generations Defined report that we released earlier this year. And it was this really interesting look by generation at which generation says, you know, values and ethics are important to them as consumers, and then which ones are actually for them, which ones is it translating into actual behavior where they say, no, I won't buy that because that brand's not ethical, or what comes into it. So it's great to have more research about that coming from this study. And I'd love, Jace, for you to be able to share and take a moment to share with our listeners where Australians are at when it comes to ethical fashion, what proportion agree that it holds importance for them, and what proportion are taking it into account when it comes to their actual purchasing behaviour.
Yeah, I think it's fascinating that we are seeing this virtuous consumerism, and it's a good thing. And I think it's encouraging to see Australians, by and large, adopting values when they consider their purchases, whether it's fashion or other products. And so 7 in 10, so about 70%, agree that ethical fashion is important. But I think what's even more compelling and what's more important to note is that 70% as well would say that they want to change their shopping habits to reflect more ethical practices in the next year. And so I think that's super encouraging to see that, you know, then they don't even think that it's just important, but they're now also wanting to shift the way that they engage with their product purchases. But I think when it comes to the aspects that have the most influence on Australians and their purchasing decisions, value for money continues to be the most important factor, followed by an item being perceived as good quality, and then again, low price, which is obviously a little bit different to value for money, but again, has that factor of cost of that product. More idealistic values and value-driven factors such as buying locally sourced or made products, supporting small businesses, shopping with brands that have adopted an ethical or responsible business practice do rank fairly low on that list when we're asking consumers what are the factors that influence a decision to purchase a product. And so I think what we're seeing is there is a value for ethical consumerism. There is a value for ethical fashion. And Australian consumers are wanting to make changes in the way that they engage with the products and what they choose to buy. But I think there is still the reality of practicality and money that's available to people, or the perception of quality around these products. And I think in those contexts, some of those more idealistic values slip a little bit further down the chain of what's influential. We even asked the consumers a question asking them what matters most, affordability or purchasing in line with your values. And I think we saw something pretty compelling, and that 84% preference affordability over 16% purchasing according to their value. So I think there's some interesting data points to wrestle with and really understand that, yes, there is this trend towards ethical consumerism and purchasing along those lines. But when push comes to shove, there's some real challenges that you know, Australians are considering, and mainly that would be the cost of the items.
Yeah, it's definitely, I guess, that idea that if a product is sustainably made and ethically produced, I guess there is an expectation among consumers that it's going to cost more and that you're going to have to pay more for that because it might be more rare or that sort of thing. And yeah, in the current, of course, climate, or I mean, all we've heard about for the last year or so is rising cost of living and people having to cut costs. I mean, I've even seen even a few memes about how no one in families getting Christmas presents because everything's too expensive, you know, like it's everyone, even at this time of year, with regards to shopping, like there are some challenges there, and people I think are trying to save money and cut costs. And so, yeah, in the current climate, I think that makes sense. But I imagine as well, like the other thing I've seen with regards to our research and consumerism and consumer behavior is just the importance of simplicity and convenience. Mm-hmm. And for many of us with busy lives and time poor schedules, the idea that you have to do extra research or go and source maybe something that's a bit more unique or rare, sometimes that does kind of come at that price where you're like, mm-hmm. This brand does seem okay, and it's the price is right. I'm just going to make the purchase. And so it's interesting just to see that. And this whole study is actually makes me think about something I learned about, I think when I was at uni, which was around consumerism and just the connection between consumers and the supply chain, or how the product that we wear, or the fashion in this case, like the clothes we wear, do we think as consumers about how that was made and what conditions the people who made it are working in and all of that. And this study indicated that 7 in 10 Australians do care about fair wages, child labour and forced labour. But only 4 in 10 consider the impact of their purchases on others. So you've got this, I guess, disconnect between the 4 in 10 and the 7 in 10. Jace, how do you interpret this apparent gap between the values that we hold as consumers, but also then the gap in the actual of or translating that concern and those values and that care into actual behaviour?
It's great that you mentioned kind of those insights that you gained throughout university and learning around that. And I think what we are seeing is there is a growing awareness around ethical fashion and understanding how a product that you purchase, whatever it may be, is connected to a supply chain. And I think obviously, I mean, we saw that through 2020 with COVID and the disruptions to supply chain, or the big tanker that got stuck in the Suez Canal, and how that had such a ripple effect on supply chain issues. And so I think there is increasingly an awareness around some of these challenges. But this research set out to uncover an index score, so the Ethical Global Citizen Index. And I won't bore our listeners with too many of the details around that, but essentially it captured 5 sections, and they are agency, attitude, awareness, action, and advocacy. And these sections made up the index score, which in this year, 2023, is 63. And when we ran the same study in 2021, it was also 63. So the index score has not changed in these 2 years. But the sections themselves did change, and what makes up that score did change. And I wanted to highlight it because I think this is where, you know, this gap is between the 7 and 10 and the 4 and 10. And that principally is around awareness and action. So awareness is the section that has increased the most from 2021, being 56 2 years ago, to 61 today. And this is a positive thing, showing that organizations like Baptist World Aid that are raising awareness about this issue, that are putting out reports like this report into the public sphere, into media, on their website for consumers to engage with and actively, you know, do that research, like you were saying, whilst it may be a little bit inconvenient, at least it's raising awareness about this important issue. And then amongst that, attitude this year was the highest scoring section at 78. And so attitude measures the extent to which individuals believe ethical fashion is important. And it's capturing some of those insights, like you already mentioned, that Australians care about fair wages, they care about child labour, they care about forced labour. These are important things on a global stage that Australians are engaging with and advocate for, and you know, they're aware of it. And if you were to ask the general Australian on the street, do you care about these issues? Of course they would, and they would want to find a way to support or be involved in those initiatives. But through this research, we found that the lowest scoring section is action. And that came in at 55, which is down from 57 in 2021. And this section measures the extent to which individuals want to change their consumption habits to consume more ethically. And as we've already discussed, when it comes to it, Australians are prioritizing affordability and their own needs over purchasing according to their values. And many of those values are purported to be, you know, ethical considerations, sustainability, etc. And so I think what we're seeing is awareness is increasing. Australians have an attitude and a desire to engage with these important issues, but when it really comes to it, action is still lagging. And perhaps as awareness increases, as attitude continues to grow, perhaps we will see in 2 years' time that action will increase, and that will be a stronger score. But I think it's a really interesting kind of thing to consider when we look at that gap, that really it's that action piece. And as you mentioned, there's so many challenges and barriers around that, and influential factors as to why perhaps Australians might not be taking those relevant actions to become more ethical citizens and consumers.
Yeah, it's also just, you know, discussing all of this, the fact that we have the option to be aware of it or not, like the fact that you can be ignorant of how your clothes were made or the conditions in which the people were working in who made it, like that does just give an indication of how privileged many of us are and how removed we are from it. That's not, of course, an excuse by any means to be ignorant of it. And this is, of course, here the great work that Baptist World Aid are doing in raising awareness of that and holding brands to account by giving them that score and just informing the public and hopefully then leading to action on the brand's behalf to actually improve those conditions if we do see a change in consumer behaviour there. But I think it's just fascinating as well around the awareness piece, and that we were talking actually about this, one of our colleagues and I were talking about this when we were looking at the report, and I said, oh, interesting that this brand got this score and this score. And then we were talking about another brand, and we're not going to disclose any brand names because we're not out here to call them out publicly on this podcast. But there's one particular brand that people might be aware of by this story that has copped a lot of flack online. I think mainly on TikTok among Gen Z for that fast fashion kind of cheap stuff. And just there's been, of course, some stories or some footage or some visuals that has been leaked or released. And when you do see that and you're more aware, then, of course, because we do see that, as we said, 7 in 10 Australians care about fair wages and forced labour. When we see that that's happening and connected to a brand, we do call them out and rightly so. So it's interesting that even how social media can kind of rally the troops or just take something and amplify it, which is of course what it does. But yeah, that awareness about ethical fashion has seen a rise, as you mentioned. And another way of interpreting that, not with the score but with the percentages, is that 42% engage regularly in information about ethical consumption compared to 30% in the last time this study was conducted. Jace, how do you think this increased awareness translates or can translate into more conscious consumer choices, especially as we've said, considering that for many, for about a third, finding ethical consumption too expensive? And of course, we all understand that we're in that climate, in that context at the moment, but how do you think this increased awareness can translate into consumer change and consumer choices?
Mm. I'll jump into some of those actions that consumers are already taking, but I wanted to just echo what you've already mentioned anecdotally about some of the way that younger generations are engaging with this content that are coming their way through social media platforms like TikTok and others. And you know, that question that you referenced, or the stat that 42% engaging regularly in information, is information distributed via podcasts like this one and others and social media platforms. So there is an increase in that engagement on that front. But I wanted to highlight that younger generations, so Gen Z and Gen Y, are the ones that are actually driving the increased awareness of the impact of their purchasing decisions on others. Specifically, 80% of Gen Z say they are more aware of the impact of their purchasing decisions now as opposed to 3 years ago. And that's followed by Gen Y at 75%, Gen X 68%, and baby boomers 55%. And so this isn't a comment on the generations on that regard, but it is clear that, you know, Gen Z and Gen Y, the younger generations, are consuming this content, and it's helping form a more ethical consideration and value set as they make their product purchases. So, as I mentioned, Australians are already making steps towards being more virtuous consumers. And some of the ways that they're doing that are reducing the amount of products that they buy in the next 12 months. Over half are learning to responsibly dispose of something they no longer need. Half are also learning how to repair something that they maybe something's broken, and they, instead of throwing it out when they would have done that in the past, they're saying that they want to now learn how to repair that so that they don't have to make another purchase. Others are learning how to properly care for and wash their clothes so that it prolongs the longevity of that item. And 41% are likely to buy secondhand over brand new. And, you know, over the last few months, I've been going to these kind of vintage clothing or pre-loved markets and stores, and it's been super fascinating to see how that's risen in popularity. And it's a lot of younger people. They want to have, you know, the designer items maybe, but they don't have the money to make those purchases. But also there's a ethical consideration that they come with, that they don't want to just contribute to this fast fashion cycle, and that they're engaging with these pre-loved kind of markets and opportunities. And so I think by and large, there is progress and Australians are making these changes, but the stats across all of those measures are still fairly mid-range. So most of them are around 50s and 40 mark. And so I think that provides an opportunity. Whilst there are actions being taken, that there's still much to be done and Australians can continue to take these small and simple steps really to become more ethical in the way that they engage with fashion. And I think it's worth mentioning that, you know, across these measures that I've just discussed, many of them are also great money saving, you know, little hacks or behaviors. So, you know, instead of disposing something and buying a new item, learn how to fix it or learn how to properly care for those clothing items or whatever it may be so that they last longer. Buying secondhand, again, is a lot more affordable than buying a brand new product. And so I think when Australians are saying that they value cost of money, the cost of an item or the value of an item over some of those more idealistic factors, I think there really is an opportunity for companies, advocacy organizations like Baptist World Aid to connect ethical considerations or ethical values and ethical products with actually being more affordable and being more in line with those values of purchasing something that is within their means and within their budget. I think that's an important bridge to be gapped in this front.
Yeah, absolutely. It's definitely, yeah, great to see, like you mentioned, all those points there around what actions Australians from this study are taking to be more conscious consumers and ethical in their behaviour and their consumption decisions. I find just particularly, yeah, the secondhand clothing market, or just not clothing, but accessories or consumer goods, a really interesting one. I think, I mean, we've got a few colleagues in the team who are of a younger generation who do like to shop that way. And it's been really interesting as well, I think, to engage and talk about conversations with them where they wear something new to the office and you're like, oh, like, love that new jacket. They're like, yeah, I got it from Vinny's or whatever it might be. And you're like, oh, such a good reminder that you don't have to go and buy all new products to feed that cycle, and it can benefit more than just your own personal savings or your finances. It's got benefits there around, yeah, giving the life cycle of a product a lot longer. And also just more broadly, these are just very anecdotal Ashley Fell thoughts at the moment, but one of the things I've talked about and discussed with people in light of the pandemic is, I feel, and this is just a big brushstroke comment, I don't have stats or data to back this up, but I think about pre-pandemic consumer behavior, and it was very much like everyone was on the keep cup train and we were all really conscious of the environment and our consumer decisions. And then the pandemic happened and we were all using single plastics to be safe, and oh, you can't take your keep cup to the cafe because that's spreading germs and spreading the virus. And like, it was obviously our health priority shot up the list above all of that. And so that, I feel like, was a bit of a step back for that particular facet of consumerism and ethical and virtuous consumerism. But I think it's fascinating to see in this regard, with regards to your comment earlier, Jace, about like the silver lining of, one of the silver linings of the pandemic could be that it alerted us to more of that supply chain and the importance in our products, where they come from and their availability of them. And so it's just interesting to evaluate different, or put different lenses over the discussion. And here, of course, we're talking about fashion specifically. So it's great to see that people are taking those steps. But as we have talked about a little bit already, there are some barriers that do prevent people from being able to do that in those different categories. I mean, affordability is probably the most current one, as we've discussed, because we're all across the world and here in Australia, well and truly, living through a bit of a rising cost of living crisis is the word that we keep hearing. Do you have any other insights, Jace, from this study about other barriers that present themselves for people when it comes to wanting to bridge that gap between the desire to behave in an ethical way, but then translating that into consumer behavior?
There's many barriers. And I think, like you mentioned, cost of living, the expense associated with the product that, you know, Australians are wanting to purchase is the main barrier that's listed. Others also say it's harder to know what is ethically sourced or produced, and specifically that relates to a in-store product. A lot of consumers are saying that they don't know when they go into a store if this is an ethically sourced product, whereas online I think there's often little tags associated, you know, on that platform. When you're looking at the product, it might have, you know, a little bit more of a write-up and a description that you can read through quite easily. And so I think an online avenue does make it a little bit easier, but in store, where a lot of people are still making their purchases, it can be a little bit more difficult. And also just not knowing where to get information on what is ethical or how to make those informed decisions. And so that's obviously one of the purposes of this report. But I think for me, as I was even just reflecting on what you were sharing and what we were discussing a little bit earlier about some of the steps that Australians are already taking in becoming more virtuous consumers, I think perhaps some of these barriers, and it's a question that I was asking myself. So if I perceive buying something that's ethically sourced as more expensive, is that just a perception or is that also the reality? And I think that's a thing that I've had to wrestle with as I've gone through this research and looked at the data. Are these barriers that we have to make these more ethical purchases and considerations more of a perception or reality? And I don't have the data to speak to that, but it's a question that I've been thinking about as I've looked at these data sets.
Yeah, and that was something I think I thought about as well, especially when I was looking at the brands and the brand names and how they were ranked or scored on their ethicalness. And yeah, it was interesting, even just like there were a lot of brands there who are competitors with one another and who offer similar types of clothing. And for me, even it was just empowering at least to have some data-led insights about, well, if I was to choose between these two, like if I was shopping and I had two items that were similar, like to have, I feel like that report empowered me to know, well, if I care about these things and I want my behavior to align with my values, then I should go and shop at X brand rather than Y brand, so to speak. Because it's just knowledge is power, I guess, because as we've seen in your answer there, a lot of people just can state that they just don't have knowledge of how brands behave or which one's more ethical. So you kind of, what's that saying? It's like almost like you can just rely, or you can use the excuse that you just don't know. Ignorance is bliss or whatever it might be. You know, like, oh, I just don't know. So who doesn't matter? I can't be held to account because I don't know. Whereas again, if you go and read this report, you are equipped with a bit more knowledge about how brands are operating and how they're being scored. So again, kudos to Baptist World Aid for doing this. And again, it was a privilege to be involved in it. We did see as well in this study, and this is not surprising to me based on the research we've done, exploring other related themes in different studies around the responsibility or who Australians think are responsible. And it's often not me or not I, it's not the individual, but it's kind of, oh, well, it's governments and companies, you know, bear that responsibility, which there isn't, of course, an element of truth to that for addressing these key issues in the fashion industry. Jace, how do you think this collective demand for stringent regulations and corporate initiatives drives or can drive positive change in the ethical and sustainable practices of the fashion supply chain? Big question to end with, Jace.
It's a huge question, and I'm not sure if I'm inherently qualified to make that comment, but the research and the data, you know, and these are what Australians are sharing, you know, when it comes to the sentiment around who is responsible. And so we can take this to you know, mean that yes, Australians are looking to government and legislative bodies to carry the brunt of the responsibility, so to speak, of making these shifts and guiding Australia as a society to a more ethical place. And I think that's perhaps not a misplaced sentiment, but we did ask this question kind of in a set of questions asking who's responsible: government, parties, companies, not-for-profits, and consumers. And so we saw that, yes, most Australians are looking to government to make these changes and to guide this this progress on this front. So some of the things that they're looking to see implemented is you know, starting with legislation to provide a framework and regulations for companies to operate in, and to further implement the recommendations that have been made through a Modern Slavery Act review, which took place recently. And so there's so much that can be done to further support and really provide a foundation for companies to operate more ethically in Australia and globally. But as we also look to companies, consumers are expecting them to do their due diligence in ensuring that the products that they are making are made without child labor, that the workers have a suitable wage for their basic needs and to live, and you know, that it's without forced labor across the supply chain. And so Australians are really wanting to hold these brands, like you're saying, to account for the decisions that they're making. And yes, they want to have the products and they want to engage with the things that they're selling, but they're also looking to those companies to make the necessary changes to be more ethical in the way that they manufacture the products. But I think I wanted to end with just a, not a challenge, but an invitation. And I think this is part of what the research is wanting to do, is to really look at the consumer. So yes, the government has an opportunity and a responsibility to carry out these large scale changes and these legislation changes and regulation. Yes, companies are required to do their due diligence, but what about the consumer? This is an ethical consumer report. And how are we making the decisions? How are we purchasing products actually aligned with our values, and not just saying this is what we believe or we want to be more ethical in our behavior and our product purchasing, but actually then translating that to action. And I think that's the invitation that this research really provides to anyone that reads it and engages with it. And I hope that, and I'm taking it on as I've gone through this research, that perhaps the values that I hold need to actually then be translated to the actions that I take. And it is a challenge because there's so many things like convenience or cost, and those are factors and no one's disregarding that or diminishing that, but there's an opportunity for us to become more ethical global citizens, which, you know, is the foundation of this research and what Baptist World Aid has set out to accomplish.
Mm. And I'm sure not by any stroke of luck, or I imagine it's a very strategic decision as well to be releasing this at this time or in recent months, because the rampant consumerism, we see it all around us at this time of year with Christmas and sales, and it's just, it's a lot. It's very, even like the FOMO of missing out on a sale and just pushing you to, as or pushing us as consumers to buy things that we don't actually need, or it's a really important piece of work, I think. And it's, again, I use the word empowering. I feel like this research is empowering because it does equip you with some confronting stats that you can kind of, or that we can as readers of this report, you know, evaluate against, but then also equips you with knowledge of how different brands are operating and gives them that score. And again, just, enables us to, I think, be empowered, but hopefully it doesn't just end there and go, oh, that's interesting, but to actually translate, like you said, Jace, that challenge there into actually, consumer behavior. And I think it can feel at times when we talk about these altruistic kind of endeavors where it's like, oh, but what difference can I make as just little old me in the world? But actually, if that's how movements, of course, get made, and brands do rely on people buying their products to survive. And so if we are able to make a change with our purchasing behavior to benefit people all over the world who are involved in these particular supply chains for fashion, I think that's a really great initiative. And as you started out at the beginning of the episode saying, one of our key values at McCrindle here is to empower human flourishing through the use of data and insights and wisdom applied through research. And so this is really just the outworking of that in its true form, I think, which has just been a privilege to be involved in. So thank you so much, Jace, for coming on the podcast today, for being involved with this work. And shout out, of course, to Baptist World Aid. I know that if people just type in Baptist World Aid Ethical Fashion Guide into Google, that link comes up right away. And there's a beautiful interactive website as well that they've kind of created. Is that where you'd point people to, Jace, in terms of if they want to find out more about this research?
Yeah, that's a great page for understanding where brands fit in their ethical production and manufacturing of their goods. But the research specifically around this one is the ethical consumer piece, which is also on that same website. And yeah, also thanks to Be Slavery Free, who partnered with Baptist Sword Aid in this research as well.
Yeah, awesome. Thanks so much, Jace. Thanks for your time on the podcast. It's been a delight to have you on this season a couple of times. So thank you very much.
It's been great. Thanks so much, Ash.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can also follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.